Hello, my name is Tony Stott. I started campaigning on men's issues over 15 years ago, and I became so disillusioned and despairing because nothing I or others did seemed to make any difference. I fully expected Mike Bell's decision to approach MPs and Parliament to be yet another total waste of effort. How wrong I was. Not only is there now an APPG of MPs looking into men's and boys' issues, conducting research and producing evidence-based reports for change, but the proposal that Parliament should have a Minister for Men was seriously discussed at a fringe meeting at the last Conservative Party conference. How did this startling turn of events come about? How is Mike Bell so successful? What is Mike doing that is different? Myself and others have been campaigning for years, with little or no effect. What did you do that's different?
Well, I think the first thing to recognise is that setting up the APPG and what have you, I was working closely with Mark Brooks, and he has a similar approach to mine. He might not give the same answers to your questions, but we seem to have a working partnership there, which works very well. I think that I benefited from the fact that in the 1980s, I campaigned on green issues and got to know Parliament a bit. And met MPs. And what I found is they're much more ordinary than most people think. They're not the monsters. In those days, people thought that MPs were monsters out to just destroy the environment. And I hear similar stories from men's rights people who think that the MPs are out to destroy men. And I just find people in general fairly ordinary, perhaps badly informed, and so in need of information rather than to be shouted at. And I think I also assume that people are, that nearly everybody's a decent human being, that if they got an opinion which is different from mine, then they may be misinformed or just mistaken. I don't tend to think that there are bad people. I think I try to be polite. I don't do something when I'm feeling angry. I think I just do something quite regularly. I do a bit each day, or certainly every week. And I think connected with that idea of decent human being, I tend to see the positives. So that if an MP, for instance, says one good thing in one speech, I'll tend to think, oh, that's a good thing to latch on to. Whereas I think some people, see that they voted for some bit of legislation which is clearly hostile to men, and therefore sort of label them, oh, he or she is a feminist. We can't have anything to do with them. And also, once we started the APPG, after a few months, Nick Fletcher turned up, which was quite unexpected. So that's been extremely helpful. Also, Lord Michael Farmer has become active.
What did you actually do to start the APPG and get that fringe meeting, Mike?
Well, I think that what's important to understand is that it was fairly straightforward. I wouldn't say that it was easy, but we didn't really hit major obstacles and we didn't need to have any insider information. So when Chris Badley contacted me and suggested the idea of an APPG, which I think was in early December, a couple of years ago, we spent a bit of time over the Christmas period compiling lists of MPs and peers, and then just started emailing them in late December. And you have to have a certain number and you have to have a certain spread across the parties. But we'd achieved that by the middle of February, and we had the first meeting in the middle of March. So we didn't have to persuade anybody, we only had to give them the opportunity. It did involve, I mean, we did I did send a lot of emails. I didn't need to know how to send bulk emails, if you know what I mean. It was just a matter of doing it. And also, you know, you might say, well, how did you know how to start it? Well, actually, if you look on the Parliament website, you can find a guide to starting it, to running an APPG. And the office was very helpful and told us what to do and what we still needed. So that was how we started the APPG. And then the Fringe meeting, again, it's just fairly straightforward. I was talking to somebody who had been handing out leaflets outside a Conservative Party conference a year or two ago. And I said, well, why didn't you run a Fringe meeting on the inside? And this person said, well, they'd never let you do that. And I'm thinking, well, why not? Because I used to run Fringe meetings in Lib Dem conferences, you know, on environmental issues. And so I thought that it may well be just as straightforward. So I Googled Conservative Party conference and then emailed them and said, how do I run a Fringe meeting? And they sent me the form. And, you know, it's like, it, and then I invited MPs and other members of the APPG if they would speak, and they said yes. So there's no great trick to it. It was just assuming that it's going to work and doing it, I would say.
Sounds so easy. But it seems clear to me, Mike, that there's a major feminist lobby in Parliament which prevents people speaking out on men's issues, a culture of fear, I think, which in Parliament. And it seemed to me, I just have this feeling or assumption that approaching MPs is pointless. Isn't this kind of misandry proof that the male lobby exists?
Well, certainly society as a whole and Parliament, you know, reflecting it, is biased against men at the moment. There is definitely a dominant anti-male narrative in society. And it's certainly true that there are some very effective, what you might call radical feminists in Parliament, and certainly in the machinery that leads up to it, that is the sort of the organizations which advise government on various things, do contain, I would say, a relatively small number of highly effective people who take quite a radical view. But on the other hand, I don't think that's true of the vast majority of parliamentarians. That's certainly not what I've experienced. And your question is quite a common one. So I have interviewed two MPs and two peers, members of the APPG. Again, they were perfectly willing to be interviewed, and you can see them on the YouTube channel. And I ask all four of them this exact question, you know, is there something in Parliament stopping you raising men's issues? And they all say no. In fact, Nick Fletcher said, if anybody tried to stop me saying what I wanted to say, I'd want to say it even more. And he is quite outspoken. Just the other day, he's quite openly asked for a minister for men yet again. And Baroness Eaton, who's been quite active in the APPG, was laughing in her response. She said that there's utterly ridiculous that nobody has ever tried to stop her raising any issue. So I said, so why is Parliament so biased against men? Why are these issues not being raised? And she says, because nobody's raising them. That's what I've experienced. Just to give you another example, I discover there's things called parliamentary questions. That is, if an MP asks a question of a minister, the minister is required to answer. You know, whereas if a member of the public wants the minister to answer, you've got to, you know, get 1,000 signatures on them. So I've just been, we're just writing parliamentary questions and sending them to MPs and asking them to ask them. Well, half the time they say yes and just send them in. And then, so I've done that about 20 times. If I had more time and more focus on it, we could do parliamentary questions every day.
I hear what you're saying. My experience and the experience of others is that we write and we email and we just get a blank response. And those are sincere attempts by men to raise issues. And we get new anti-male legislation. We get the anti-male narrative just gets worse. You know, it really seems to prove that there is a conspiracy blocking men's issues being raised. If there isn't a conspiracy, why do so many of us experience that?
Well, firstly, in general, I don't believe in conspiracy theories. I don't think it's possible for a small group of people. People are just not clever enough to be that well organized and at the same time remain largely hidden. So in general, I don't go for conspiracy theories. I think that there are people working effectively, but I think that the effect that we see is more cultural than conspiratorial. So if you get non-replies to letters, for instance, or bland replies to letters, I think that may give you the impression that there's a sort of a machinery in place which tells MPs not to respond positively to men's issues. But if you think about an MP's office, when you write to your MP and you get a reply, you're not getting the reply from the MP, probably. It may have been cleared with them. But this poor old secretary researcher in the office receives dozens, maybe 100 emails a day. And they have to have a machinery in place for dealing with all these requests. I mean, obviously, they have to deal with their constituents' particular concerns, and they'll deal with those with a caseworker in their constituency. But if you think about the MP's office, they have to do a kind of cut and paste answer. So what you should expect is that when you sent your first email in, you get one of these bland responses. If you assume that you're going to get a bland response and you need to go with a second and a third one and maybe phone the office, you'll start to make progress. But what's wrong is to assume that there is something in place stopping them giving a positive answer. Another reason that I've heard that men are convinced that there's some sort of conspiracy is because, let's say, several different people write into different MPs and ask the same question. And then miraculously, they all get roughly the same answer. So, you know, it's a cut and paste version. Well, again, I've quizzed these office wallers about this, and they say, well, that's pretty straightforward. That if we get a question we don't know the answer to, then we refer it to another part of the organization, and they send us a template answer. So that explains that, but it could be misinterpreted as a conspiracy blocking men's issues. And of course, the third reason why you might think it's a conspiracy is because things continue to get worse. That is, new anti-male legislation is being passed as we speak. So therefore, you know, again, that gives the impression of a conspiracy. But I'm not sure that that's the case. I think that because of the cultural climate, because the general culture is, you know, gynocentric or anti-male, people, and because the people driving this narrative are very effective, far, far, far more effective than anybody in the men's movement, you could think of it a bit like the problem of changing the direction of the oil tanker, if you know what I mean. That is, we have started to change the narrative on men's issues, but the juggernaut is still running. And I think in order to feel positive, you have to think, well, the juggernaut is still going, but let's look on the bright side. You know, we did have a International Men's Day debate, and, you know, several people made positive noises on these issues, and this is better than it was a few years ago.
Right, okay. But you also referred to getting a number of bland or non-responses. You know, you have to work your way through. Don't you find that, I mean, you're dealing with large numbers of MPs and so on. Don't you find that discouraging, dispiriting?
I think I get less negative or bland responses than other people because I go about it in a way which is less likely to trigger that response, if you know what I mean. If somebody sends a hostilely written email, then the poor old Waller in the office doesn't really know how to respond. But if you, what I've learned is, don't ask more than one question, for instance, and ask it in a fairly straightforward way. You know, not why haven't you done anything about boys' lower achievement in GCSEs? I would say something like, is there anything that we can do about boys' underachievement in GCSEs? I also think that I've got a different underlying model of change. I didn't realize this until I was talking to other people, is that I think some people think I'm going to write to my MP and then I'll get a response. And then when they don't get a response, they get demoralized. Or they say, we'll do this and then this will happen and then the law will be changed or whatever. And when it doesn't happen, you get demoralized. Well, I don't think that at all. I think that you just do stuff and then something positive happens and you kind of hone in on the positive and try and build from there. And then you just do some more stuff and then something else happens. So that, for instance, the thing about the Minister for Men, as the our little APPG team, myself, Mark and Chris, were discussing what issues we would address first. We decided to go for the less controversial issues like boys' underachievement in school or male suicide, those sorts of issues, where almost nobody, even the most radical feminist, almost they wouldn't say, you know, improving exam results for boys is hostile to women, or that if we reduce the number of men taking their own lives, that this is really bad for women, if you know what I mean. So we thought that we would start on those issues and that we specifically wouldn't campaign for, say, a minister for men because we thought that was too difficult. Well, Nick Fletcher just decided to ask for it. I mean, we didn't say, hey, Nick, you know, how about minister for men? He just said one day, I'm going to ask for a minister for men. I've got a oral question next Thursday. And so he just gets up in Parliament and he says, because he's from Doncaster and they want a new hospital, he says, I've got this opportunity to ask the minister, and maybe people will think that I'm going to ask for a hospital for Doncaster. But in fact, I'm going to ask for a minister for men. And then maybe another time I can ask for a hospital of Doncaster. So he very cleverly asked two questions in one. but that wasn't us. That came spontaneously from him.
Right.
So, yeah, I don't know whether that helps. Is that a reasonable answer to your question?
Yes. I think so. You've touched on the presence of radical feminists, and how one of the things I struggle with is how can I have a dialogue with feminists when they spread such misandry, and you know I find them can be so rabid and hate filled and totally deaf to anything that is a challenge or you know is men's issues, boys' issues. They just don't want to know. How do you deal with that?
Well, I don't address radical feminists directly. And as I said earlier, I think there are a small number of radicalized people. And I think if you challenge them, it just makes them worse. That is, they will be convinced that society really is a patriarchy, and, you know, the toxic masculinity and all this other stuff they come out with, simply because you're raising men's issues. So, but the overwhelming majority of parliamentarians are not like that. And therefore, I seem to be talking to people who, you know, may hold some of these views, but I would say largely out of ignorance rather than out of ideology. And therefore, it's relatively easy to talk to them. You have a perfectly straightforward conversation. I think that the success of the radicals is simply because so many people are going along with them, not because they are particularly powerful themselves, if you know what I mean. Their power is that other people go along with them.
I feel feminism is so overwhelmingly successful, and in becoming coercive, dominating, and controlling, like you said about the culture. How has that come about, do you think, that it's become so successful?
Well, I think that people are very open to ideology, that, if you like, one shouldn't be so surprised that that it's successful, because throughout history, people have been very open to ideologies. And obviously, at the extreme level, you know, sort of Nazism or communism are ideologies which people have adopted. So it's actually quite common for large parts of a nation to be taken over by an ideology. So I don't think we should be that surprised that society has been taken over by this current, you know, what do you call it, woke or anti-male narrative, because it's almost the norm in society. In a way, if you think back in history, when people believed in, you know, different gods or in spirits in the woods or, you know, these type of things, they are similar kinds of ideologies that huge numbers of people believed in. And with that, you know, if you sort of say an ideology is a set of ideas mm-hmm. which isn't grounded in reality. So that's the first.
Good to hear you say that. Yeah, okay.
So for a short period of time, for about 300 years in the history of mankind, we've had this era, which you might call it the empirical era, since the scientific revolution in the late 17th, 18th century, where people have focused more on evidence.
Right.
But not everybody in society. But on the particular issue of this anti-male narrative, I think there are deep evolutionary reasons for the rise of feminism. And the main one is that we men have evolved in a way which means we can identify as members of the family or the tribe or the country or the football team or any number of other groups. But what we can't do is identify as a member of the group called men, to help defend men. And the reasons for this is, again, just evolutionary. If you imagine the small tribe and the most important people for the future of the tribe are the fertile women, pregnant women, and the children. If those people are not defended, there is no future for the tribe. You can lose a few men and still continue. But if you lose the fertile women and the children, the tribe has had it. So that evolutionary driver has made us gynocentric. So now in the modern world, of course, we're not facing great enemy or tigers or whatever it is. But our psychology, our men's psychology, means that we don't identify, we don't tend to look out for other men. Now, if you think about a tribe that where men evolved to look after other men. So there they are out facing the carnivorous animals. And the men are concerned about the other men. They will take actions which will protect themselves and other men. Meanwhile, the marauding animals have eaten the women and children. So it's vital that we evolved so men did not look out for themselves. And this is, of course, exploited by the this new thing of feminism. So as part of that process, men are naturally stoical. That is, when we feel, you know, negative emotions, we tend to just put up with it, just get on with it. Although we know the names of, you know, 12 different emotions, generally speaking, men are either happy or all right or angry. Perhaps not angry. There's lots of other words, you know, like sort of exasperated or, you know, a sort of strong negative emotion. So generally speaking, if we're in our happy or our okay mood, we just plod along. And we're not naturally disposed to look after other men. And we can only do it when we're in that high energy negative state. And so we tend to then do the wrong thing. We send the angry email, we shout at somebody. And so we are less effective. So I think those are the sorts of explanations that I would have, which have allowed this radical feminism to develop as an ideology. I think also if you think about the other characteristics of men, we tend to be competitive. So we find it quite hard to work in a large group and come to a consensus. A group of people working towards an objective can be, you know, quite damaged by a highly competitive male who thinks they know the answer and wants everybody else to agree with them. So I think there are, you know, reasonably well-established reasons why the anti-male narrative has developed.
That's explains the idea or the perception of this dominant feminine narrative and the power, coercive control. Do you think things are getting better, or do you think things are getting worse?
Well, obviously, some things are getting worse in so much as the legislation is going through. For instance, we tried to make a noise about the Istanbul Convention, but it's been passed, and the long-term consequences of that could be quite negative, for instance. And a group of feminists have managed to start to persuade government about that men are dangerous to their children and that the courts are letting too many men have contact with their children, which appears to be based on no evidence whatsoever, just using this sort of natural gynocentrism of somebody saying, oh, children are being, and women are being affected. We've done a survey and there's lots of upset women and they're having an unreasonable effect. But on the other hand, I was lucky enough to bump into Philip Davis at the Conservative Party conference. And so I had a chat with him and he was reflecting on the International Men's Day debates over the last 6-7 years. And people often refer to the time right at the beginning when he's asking for the first time to the backbench committee for an International Men's Day debate. And Jess Phillips is quite scathing about the idea. But she didn't succeed. They did have the International Men's Day debate and she hasn't said anything negative since. And Philip Davis reports quite a lot of hostility to his initial standing up for men attitude. And Ben Bradley, 2 years ago, led the International Men's Day debate and asked for a minister for men then. And he says he got quite a lot of flack. But what's interesting is that Nick isn't getting anything like that amount of flack. I think that he's able to ask in a way which is very straightforward, like, as you know, can we have a new hospital and can we have a minister for men? Just sort of like treating this as a normal thing to ask for rather than a radical thing to ask for. So I think things are getting better. Just as an example, I didn't get the figures for this year, but I think when Nick Fletcher asked, put the notice round in Parliament for people who wanted to speak in the International Men's Day debate, he got 35 signatures. Now, obviously, by no means, not all those people spoke, but 35 people signed the form. So, yeah, I think things are improving. Oh, the other thing is that what really, really surprised me, I was totally unexpected, was walking around the Conservative Party conference with our leaflet. You know, on one side, it told you where the fringe meeting was. And on the other side, you just had like 10 statistics about men and boys, you know, underachieving in school, 75% of suicides and, you know, more deaths from COVID. And I simply asked people, showed them that side of the leaflet, and said, are you interested in any of these topics? And 95% of people said yes. I didn't expect the venue to be full. I thought about 30 people would turn up. In fact, about 80 people turned up. And I fully expected there to be hostile questions, but there weren't any. So I think, yes, things are improving, but I would say, in answer to all your questions in this session, is that there's a myth around about the difficulty of doing this. There is much less difficulty than many people think.
So what would you say to somebody who wants to be effective then?
Well, I think just get on with it. I mean, just do some stuff, but don't be too concerned about success. I mean, it may well be that you send something off and you get no response. Just keep chugging away. A few years ago, a couple of lines occurred to me in response to a question like yours, you know, nothing has any effect. So the first line is nothing has any effect. But the second line is nothing has no effect. So if you were to write to your MP and get a bland or zero response, you could say, well, nothing has any effect. But if lots of people write and then next week he reads something else, you know, like a newspaper article, and then, do you know what I mean? And we should think about it a bit more like selling a new chocolate bar. That if you were to start marketing your new chocolate bar and you advertised it once and hardly anybody bought it, and then you went back to your factory and said, the chocolate bar's a failure, you know, people would laugh at you. Well, of course, you don't expect to sell lots of chocolate bars from one set of advertising. And I think you should think about that, that we're basically trying to sell an idea, a new idea to people, which they may not be familiar with. And therefore, you just got to keep plodding away at it. I do think it's vital to approach people as though they're a decent human being and not be angry with them. I think it's really important to do something regularly. You know, just sort of plod away, I think, you know, a bit like you might do in your garden, just go and do a bit every now and again. And then in the summer, suddenly you get a nice... something comes into flower which you hadn't anticipated.
Well, thank you, Mike. Your approach is very different from myself and most other people campaigning on men's and boys' issues. However, from our discussions, I'm going to take a different approach in response to a particular current situation in which I'm involved. If I'm going to be successful in doing that, it's going to be a journey. And the change is not going to be quick or easy for me. And I suspect many other people involved in men's and boys' issues will find the same. I'm just wondering if the men's movement is generally being ineffective in the way we're doing things, and if it's going to be a struggle to change. I'm wondering if you see a way forward. What do you think we can do today and tomorrow and onwards that will actually make a difference?
Yes, I do agree that a majority of men will do find this very difficult. And it occurs to me that probably the best way forward is not to try to persuade men to change. But it's highly likely that among all the people who've been men, particularly men who've been hurt by things, there are some people with some money. And that if we could set up an office, say, with two or three people who work full time, if you were to get the kind of person who works for an MP, you know what I mean, kind of vaguely politically savvy, but you know, with office type of skills, we could make massive progress, far more progress than could be made by, you know, even quite a large organization of volunteers. For instance, we've just had this International Men's Day debate, just to take this one thing that's happened, you know, and we need somebody to go through the Hansard, pick out the points, write to each of those MPs, pick up something which the mistake that they've made, or in those speeches given to the fringe meetings, some, you know, one or two people said things which are just fundamentally inaccurate. You know, we can just get the figures from the Office of National Statistics to show them that they are wrong. And so there's an infinite amount of that sort of thing to do. And it would be all relatively easy to do. Do you see what I mean? Is you just do it. And another thing, hardly any Labour MPs. There were no Labour MPs in the debate. You know, so we could just write to all the Labour MPs saying, can you tell us why you didn't take part in the International Men's Day debate? So there's a huge amount of stuff. So if there's anybody out there with organisational skills like that, I don't think I have the skills to set up such an office. I'm fairly sure we could raise the money for it. But I don't know how to do that at the moment.
Well, thank you, Mike. Very interesting and challenging, I would say. But illuminating, I think. You'd be very clear, in my opinion, about what you do differently to most of us and how it's worked. And to some extent, I think, has surprised you in some ways. So, but I think thank you for, you know, for the time. Thank you for reopening your views and how things could be different. And let's hope that somebody, some people, step forward and we can get that supercharged office to do what you do more.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to answer.